last class, it seems that a lot of people have skipped. we have. Let's go. We have our attendance form as always. Okay. Please. Alright. So, some announcements. This will be our last discussion session. So, the next 3 weeks we'll have bonus lectures that will only be held on Monday. And there will be no meetings on Wednesdays. And also, you do not need to come to these Monday lectures. They're not mandatory. However, if you do want to learn extra information about how we utilize Android, as well as some of the extra frameworks that we utilize, please come. Starting next week, we will have the talking about Jetpack Compose. So hopefully you guys are there. Now, we'll just go over a quick overview on what we learned yesterday. So, starting off, there is data. We want to be able to maintain, or we want to be able to transfer data across many aspects of our app in a global setting. And in this case, we would use Singleton. While they are found upon in complex apps, we still widely use them. And the thing is about them is that we use a Singleton to be able to transfer data between fragments by keeping them in a globalized fashion. And so you can access them from any activity. Next, you have storage. So, say for example, you actually want to store information within your app locally so that between different times you've been opening up your app, the information remains. For this would be a high score, this would be logins, anything of those sorts. And for this, we would use shared preferences. And the way shared preferences work is it's very similar to the way we did intents. It just holds key value pairs for the key, which you call or you use to get the actual value that it represents, that it's pointing to. Next, we have networking. So, for networking, we are using Moshi. So, just a reminder, why we use Moshi is due to the fact that we want to be able to convert the JSON files that we get through our networking into actual usable code in the form of a calling object. So, the way Moshi works is you define your own data class, and Moshi interpreter will interpret these JSON files that you get into the classes that you've built out without you needing to actually parse all the data yourself. Finally, to actually make these requests and get the JSON files, we use what is called OKHTTP. This is a very easy version or easy library in order to actually make requests to any backend API that you want. It is a lot more intuitive than the native support for actual HTTP requests. So this, if you remember from last or on Monday, you simply put in the URI, do .get, put in a header, and then it writes the HTTP request for you, and then sends out the request for you. And it is a lot more easy than actually having to write everything out yourself. So, in addition to actually supporting GET requests, it also supports POST requests, though you will need to require a request body. And just a reminder for all the things that we've gone over today on Monday, they are all in the textbook and in the implementations are there, and so for you to refer to. So you shouldn't be burdened down by the actual syntax, but instead try to understand how everything actually works so that in the future you might be able to parse this information or from one library to the other, due to the fact that once you learn one library, it's very easy and intuitive to understand how all the other libraries work. And now, it's just demo time.
All right, so today we'll be trying to go over a demo with a quick or a simple reminders app where users can add reminders and hold on to them in this main one screen. The main idea of this demo is that we'll be going over the data aspect and the shared preferences aspect of, that's persistent storage, of this unit, subunit networking, persistent storage. So whereas on lecture we cover the more networking side, today we'll be covering the local storage that's on your phone rather than on some server somewhere else. So to start off with today's demo, we'll be pretty much starting with the empty project, an empty, completely blank Kotlin project. And I suppose to start off, we will ask you guys to sort of make a recycler view that's able to create or show or display a set of reminders, just like this, where you make a cell layout for each cell containing a title and a description, and a reminder data class that has a title and a description for each reminder. So pretty much just like we did in chapter 4 for recycle reviews, we'll be asking you to do this very quickly for reminders with a recycle review and recycle review adapter. So we'll give you some time to work through that, and we'll go over the sort of implementation of that once we are through. So we'll give you, say, 10 minutes to start with. data class, and this reminder data class has a title and a description fields, which are both strings, since each reminder will have a title and a description. And apart from that, I've also made a reminder cell, which is pretty much just a card view with the title and the description, as you most likely expect. And finally, all I have to do is sort of go through this adapter. I've just copy-pasted the sample code for the custom adapter from our textbook onto here. And now I'll fill in the information that actually allows us to use this for our reminder adapter. So first of all, change this name to reminder adapter. Our data set will be a list of reminders, not books. Change this also to reminder adapter. And in our viewholder class, we need to basically take care of the references in our reminder cell, which are the two text views here. These are the ones that we care about. So I will be changing these to, say, title text and description text. Get rid of this other one. And of course, change the IDs to the proper ones in the cell. And just like that, the view builder should be done. And next we can go into the onCreate view builder where we will specify the correct layout, which is the reminder of your cell. Moving on to onBind view builder, we'll use the references that we've made in our view builder class here instead of the placeholders. So we'll change this to title text and description text. And of course, these are no longer books, these are reminders. So we'll change this one to title, description, and this function that we refer to, the get item count, should pretty much be the same. So just like that, our adapter should be done. And so to test it out, we can go into our main activity, where I have a reference to our restart review. Here I can say add the adapter, which is a reminder adapter, which has to take in a data set. So I'm just going to make a sample data set here. The one reminder is the title, take out the trash, with a description, remember to close the lid. And one more reminder, clean the litter box, description, pull the graph. So these two reminders should show up in our recycle review, but not quite yet because I still haven't specified the linear layout. So early layout adapter, which I'm going to put as a linear layout. And I just dumped layout manager, and I'm going to set that to a linear layout so that the items displayed vertically, and it will pass that on us. And it was, which is the what's the fuss here? I think it's linear layout manager. And just like that, this should be enough. I'm missing something, so let's test this out. Make sure these two reminders actually do show up. Pull up my emulator. Trying to miss out. And I'll name the recycler view this time. And let's try that again. Wait for the build. Hopefully it doesn't crack this time. And there we go. Our recycler view is working as intended. Our two little cells here are at least showing up. So okay, that's great. Now we have a recycler view that can display reminders, if we pass it the proper list of reminders. And I guess one little improvement we could do is add a little bit of padding around the edges here, since the card layouts, or the card views, are kind of just placed right next to each other without any padding. So if you'd like to do that, you can go to the reminder cell, and I believe the attribute is called margin.
Layout margin.
For the card view. You can specify margins on the outside of the card view so that any layout that it is in will have to obey these margins and give some space on the edges. So I'll just say like add like 10 dp of margin on all sides. See if that looks any better. And now we actually have some space between each reminder. So okay, that looks pretty good. Is everybody okay with the recycle view component? Everybody's fine with that? Okay, awesome. So next, right now our recycle view is pretty much just operating off of the static list. Nothing can really be added to it, nothing can be changed. And so we want to, in this reminder app, obviously be able to allow our users to add reminders to our recycle view, or just add reminders to their list. And so the main way of handling this is with a repository. So what we want to do next is create a sort of repository that will hold on to the current reminders, the current list of reminders that our user has. And that repository will also have functions for adding reminders and later on pulling reminders from local storage, as we'll see later once we get to the shared guards part. But for now, sort of kick off the how to make a repository, and I'll have a little bit of a break so that you guys can fully implement it on your own. So we pick a Kafka class, and it doesn't really matter which one you pick, I'll just pick a file. And I'll name this a reminder repository.
Yes.
Reminder repository. Cool. Okay, so to specify a singleton or a repository, which are generally singletons, you use the object keyword. You've seen the object keyword be used before in order to instantiate one instance of an interface. In this case, we're not really extending an interface, we're just sort of making a class and making only one object or one instantiation of it, hence the keyword object. It pretty much behaves just like a regular class would, what I'll call it, reminder repository, where we can then put curly braces in. Pretty much do anything here that we would with a regular class. It's just different because the object keyword means that this class can't really be instantiated anymore. You can't make any more copies of it. This is the only copy that will exist. And in fact, if I want to reference anything in this repository, because it's a singleton, I should say in my main activity, be able to pull this up and say, reminder repository, and do whatever like function call. If I were to put stuff in the reminder repository. So what I want you guys to do is in this reminder repository, make a function first off, a field for a list of reminders that this repository will hold on to, and then a function that will add a reminder to that list of reminders. And I suppose as a little bit of an extension, if that function is called, if add reminder is called, the reminder should also show up in the recycle view automatically. So to do that, you probably want to take in the adapter for the recycle view as a parameter. So again, make a field for the list of reminders and a function to add a reminder to that list and also update it in the recycle view. So get started on that. quickly go over the repository aspect of the demo. So in order to make a list of reminders, you can pretty much just declare it as you would in any other class. So you can say var, I'll say reminders list, and you can give it a title, I'll say list of reminder, list of reminder equals, and I think I'll just initialize the list up. So that's just an empty list. And next we'll make our function for adding a reminder to this list. So we'll say fun add reminder. And this will take in a reminder. And as I said previously, an adapter for the recycler view, which will look like, should just be a recycler view dot adapter. Yes, okay. So now we just have our function body. And so in order to add the I'll just change this to a reminder adapter. That's the adapter class that we defined for reminders. And so next, what we have to do is add this reminder that we take in to our reminders list. And so in order to actually do that, we have to make the list mutable, because lists by default in Kotlin are not mutable. You can't have a dot add as you would with Java array lists. So to change that, we can change the type to mutable list and the function to mutable list of. And so now we can actually access dot add and dot remove and whatnot in the reminders list. So we can say reminders list dot add reminder. That's pretty much all I have to do to add that to the list. And so now the adapter that we take in should be, let's say, referencing this this list as its sort of data set already. So reminder adapter takes in a data set as its parameter. And so we're assuming that this adapter that we've taken in is using this list as its data set. And so now that we've added something in, we have to tell the adapter that, okay, something just changed and I need to notify you that something has changed so that you can update. And so to do that, because we've added something, we have to use a special function called, I think it's notify item inserted. And the position that we inserted it should be the end of the list, pretty much, since dot add should be adding to the end of the list. And so we can say our reminders list. This takes in the position, so we have to detail the position, which should be size minus 1, which is the last index. So now, we can test this out with making a few calls to this. Oh, and also changing the adapter to actually reference the repository list. So we can say reminder repository dot by what they call it, reminders list. So now the adapter is bound to the repositories list. And so we can test out the function a few times. Add reminder. So we can say reminder repository dot add reminder, and I wish I kept those reminders before so I could test this. Add one of these. Okay, so now this should hopefully add this one reminder to take out the trash. And I forget the things. Oh yeah, I also need to pass in the adapter, which should be recycler. I think recycler view dot adapter might give me a squiggly. This is because the adapter, like, it doesn't really like if you reference the adapter directly. So what we can do is just make a reference to this the adapter that pass in, say val adapter equals this adapter, and then just pass that into the adapter, the recycler view, and pass that in to the call to add. So now we test that. Hopefully this will make the recycler view show up with just this one reminder. And it does. So it seems like our function is working. Okay, so next, let's add a little bit of functionality for our users to add reminders to this list, which I'll just walk through very quickly. One way you might want to do this is with, obviously if it's a sort of user input, and one way you might want to do it is with a floating action button. It's basically just a button that is sort of static on your screen. There are a lot of icons that Android sort of gives you for free. So let's look for the plus here, little add button. And this is not in the right place. I'm just dragging some things straight down. Has some constraint to the. Constraint to say the bottom right of the screen. And for some reason the constraint layer is not really showing up here. Okay, there we go. That's an add. And now we can pretty much just reference this button as we would any as we would with any other component in our layout file. So we just say val add button. Equals find view by ID. We'll also have to type this with floating action button. R.ID should be called floating action button. And just with like any console listener, you can add one here too. That's just a built-in error. Do not mind that. Add button.set on the listener, just like you would any other button. And now we can say make it add a reminder. Use the this call essentially to add a reminder whenever the button is clicked. So obviously, in an actual use case, you probably want to prompt the user for a title and a description, say in another activity or with some dialogue where they can enter the description and name. But in the interest of time, I'll just set the title sort of statically here to new reminder. And put the description into something like empty description. Okay, so this error should go away. So now whenever we click this button, this should call our reminder repository to add a reminder. And every time we click it, we do see that's the case. So every time I click this, a new reminder is added. For some reason, it's going off the screen. I probably messed up the padding a little bit, but do not. A nice phone is stretching out on the screen, that's fine. Okay, well, as you can see, this is working. But what happens now if I were to go in and restart my app? So I just basically close it out, and, well, none of them save, besides this one, which I'm sort of, like, adding every time anyways. This is the only one that still shows up, because it's the only one that I'm sort of, like, hard-coded here. But all of these other ones, all these other reminders that I add, never actually get saved. And so here's where shared preferences come in. Shared preferences is a local storage for any Android device that allows you to store information in the form of key value pairs on your device. And the sort of main limitation with shared preferences is that it can only store a few types of values, and they have to be in key value pairs. So I can't really say just store a list of reminders. It's not that simple, because a list of reminders is sort of too complex of a data structure. You have to break it down into either strings, ints, booleans, the other variables. And so I think the main, or the easiest way to do it generally, the easiest way to sort of make a workaround to this is usually with strings. And so we can sort of alter our add reminder here to make a call to shared preferences and store the reminder, the new reminder that's just been made. And then every time we open our app, we can access shared preferences to pull the reminders that have been stored and then load it into the recycler view. So we have about 5 minutes left. I think I'll just sort of walk through this since shared preferences is sort of a new topic. And so I'm not sure if we'd have time to go through the entire thing. So yeah, I'll walk through it right now. So in order to get a call to shared preferences, we can use this, which is in the textbook, get shared preferences, and we need to pass in a sort of file name for our shared preferences, and we usually want to keep it private or else other apps can see the data. So we can change our file name to, doesn't really matter, I'll just say reminders. And so now this shared preferences we can use to, at any point, store information to storage. So we want to sort of pass this in as a field or some argument to our reminders repository, so that whenever we add a reminder, we can store that reminder, or at least a representation of that reminder in the form of a string, to local storage. So we'll take in another function here, or another argument here. We'll call it shared crafts, which is of type shared preferences. And with this shared preferences, we want to actually store the new reminder that we've just made. So we can do this with the call sharecrafts.edit. This will basically return an editor, which you can then use to put stuff into shared preferences. So I can say put string in order to put a string. And one way I could think about doing this is, well, I can't just put one key, because if I just put one key for every reminder, then if I add a new reminder, then that key would just be overridden. If I use the same key for every single reminder, then that key would just be overridden every single time. So one workaround I could have for this is, say, if I want to store the title, I could say title. This is the key I have to specify, kind of like a key value pair amount. I can put as my key something like title, and then a sort of other unique identifier that I can use to identify this reminder. So I'll just use concatenation here to concatenate the index in the list that this reminder appears in. So that would be reminders list.size -1. And so this would say, if I added my first reminder, it would say reminder 0, or reminder 1, or reminder 2. And then I can sort of have a for loop if I'm pulling this data to say loop through reminder 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, in order to pull these out. This is a sort of a hacky workaround to shared preferences, only allowing you to pull strings and key value pairs. So I can also do this for the description. And also pass in sort of an index here. I think I must have missed some. Let's see what's going on. Oh yeah, you have to pass in like a default value. Or no, you have to pass in the value that will pair with this key, right? Which would be the reminder.title. And here we do the reminder.description. Format that nice. And sort of the last thing we maybe want to add as well is the size of the list. And so whenever we start reading from shared preferences, if we say read a list of like 5, we know to go through title 0, title 1, title 2, title 3, and then stop there. Or did I say 5, then also title 4. And the same thing for description 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, in order to make that list of like 5. So I can say put int, I'll say list length, with the current length of the list, which is reminders list.size. And finally, this, as this message will say, you have to call either commit or apply in order to actually push those edit changes. The difference between them is that apply happens asynchronously, aka on another thread that's working through your app, so that your app doesn't ever freeze, whereas commit does it instantaneously, but has the ability to, if it's storing a lot of data, to potentially freeze your app if it's a lot that's being stored. So I'll just go apply here. And so now this should pretty much store the information that we need to rebuild the list to shared preferences. So obviously now we need to pass in the shared preferences here as a parameter, which I'll do here. And finally, the last thing that we have to do is yelling at me. What's it called? Share press. Did I call it share press? What is he even yelling at me? I can't even see the screen. Oh, this. Oh, yeah, that makes sense. Well, I'm pretty much just going to delete this call anyway, since this is just a test. Okay, so this should now be working. Let's just make sure the calls or the buttons still works. But obviously, we've only now just stored it. We aren't actually pulling it anymore. So, or we haven't pulled it yet. So, although we've stored the information, now we need a function to pull that information from the local storage. So we can make a function for that. Say init list. That'll again take in the shared preferences. And so now we need to read from shared preferences now in order to take this information and actually construct a list. So the first thing we'll want to do is query for the length of the list. So we'll say about length equals shared pref dot get int with that same key over there, which is list underscore length. And I think this also has to take in a default value, so we'll say 0. And I'll make a for loop. The for loop syntax in the problem is kind of awful, but we'll work with it anyways. I think it's for I equals 0 until length. And that might not be it. That seems about right. It's very, very strange syntax. But okay, that seems to be working. Now, of course, we need to iterate on this I. So for every I, we want to pull like title 0, title 1, or just title I, and make that our title. So we say about title, title equals shared prefs dot get string at title plus I. And that should be fine. Val description then would be kind of the same thing. Description. And okay. We also need to pass in a default value, which is this. So if for some reason this key doesn't have a value, then we'll just pass in a value to the empty string instead. And so now we need to make a reminder and add that reminder to our list. So we'll say add reminder with with a new reminder made of the title and the description, which have to be nominal. We'll also need an adapter here. To pass into the function. And we'll pass in the shared prefs. And so this should make a reminder for every list element and add it to the repository. So let's check if it actually does that. Let's make a call to init init reminder or init list with the adapter and shared prefs or shared preferences, which I declared underneath. Let me move this down. Okay, and this should hopefully, and there we go, actually have the new reminders pulled from the local storage. And so if I add, let's say this is about 8, and now actually restart, you'll see that these 8 actually do actually get pulled from the local storage. So with that, we have gone 3 minutes over time. Sorry about that, but as a final reminder, your homework due. Homework 6 is due this Sunday at 11:59. We do recognize that this is a kind of lengthy homework assignment if you have looked at the details. That is, well, I guess first of all, you can use all of your remaining slip days on this assignment, which sort of is a little bit of a way to help you through the length of it. But if you guys are struggling, please let us know. We are open to making accommodations since this is sort of a lengthy homework assignment. But that's all we have for you today. Again, apologies for going a little bit over time. We'll pull up the attendance form in just a second for anyone who came late. But otherwise, thank you for coming to our final discussion. A reminder that future weeks from now we'll not have a discussion session, only the lecture component for the bonus lectures. If you are interested in coming to those, which we highly encourage you to do, for not only just some extra information, but also for some extra credit. So, other than that, that's all we have.